Hi everyone, this is Dr. Madhuri from Team MDS Concur. Today we will discuss very important fungal infection, that is Candidiasis. If you go into the basic levels of fungi, they belong to the phylum Thallophyta or a group Eumycota. And the infections caused by this fungi are called as mycosis. Whereas mycose, the term means mushroom. And all these fungi are eukaryotes. And there is a yeast fungi which is a unicellular one. And these fungi are heterotrophs. These fungi will have a hydrolytic enzymes which will help for their food. And again, these fungi are classified to as saprobes, parasitic fungi or a mutualistic fungi. Saprobes, they will absorb nutrients from the dead organic material, whereas parasitic absorb nutrients from living host. Whereas mutualistic, that means it absorbs nutrients from a host and it also reciprocates the benefit to the host. Coming to the morphological classification, they may be molds, yeast-like fungi or a dimorphic fungi. And hyphae is called as a basic structural unit of fungi. And so here you can see the structure of the fungi with the mycelium and hyphae. And this is the reproductive structure. If these hyphae, again they are classified of three types, that is septate hyphae, aseptate or a coenocytic hyphae or Haustoria hyphae. This is a septate hyphae where you can see the septum, whereas aseptate hyphae or coenocytic hyphae, you cannot see the septum. And this is a type of Haustorium hyphae where these are of special type of hyphae where they can go and attach to the plant cells, and from the plant cells they can absorb the nutrients. And reproduction of this fungi is by asexual or asexual. Asexual is by mitosis, whereas sexual reproduction is by meiosis. There are two important terminologies like dermatophytosis and dermatomycosis. Dermatophytosis means this is a ringworm disease which involves nail, hair and the stratum corneum of the skin. Whereas dermatomycosis, it is a general name for any skin disease caused by a fungus. Coming into the classification, there are superficial and deep fungal infections. This all belongs to the deep fungal infections, which are also a granulomatous infection. Now here we will deal with the superficial and subcutaneous infection, that is candidiasis. Candidiasis is also called as a candidosis, which is an earlier term, moniliasis or a thrush. And it is caused by a fungal organism like yeast, and it is called as a Candida albicans. And most prevalent opportunistic infection. And here actually this candida will be of like a normal commensal or a saprophytic stage in the normal conditions. In the case of predisposing factors, this will become into a pathogenic organism or a parasitic stage. These are the other varieties of candida species. Among this thing, these three are more responsible for the formation of candidiasis. Along other, these are less frequently associated with the candidal infection. But all these are associated with the candidal infection. And all these candida albicans can be seen in various subjects. Like neonates, 45% of neonates can be seen this candida albicans. In healthy children, 45 to 65%, healthy adults, 30 to 45%, removable denture virus, 50 to 60%, in acute leukemia undergoing chemotherapy is 90% approximately, and in the HIV patients, you will see 95% approximately. And this will be of active in the case of 25 to 37 degrees Celsius, where there will be of penetration of the epithelial cells with the help of lipases, and so that they will overcome constant desquamation of surface epithelial cells with these lipases. So these are the predisposing factors. There are of two types, local factors and systemic factors. These all 10 reasons are because of the local factors like impaired local defense, decreased saliva production, smoking, atrophic oral mucosa, other mucosal diseases, topical medication like corticosteroids, decreased blood supply due to radiotherapy, poor oral hygiene, dental prosthesis, and altered or immature oral flora. These are the local factors. Whereas these are systemic factors like impaired systemic defense mechanisms, immunodeficiency and suppressive states, endocrine disorders, malnutrition, malignancies, congenital conditions, and broad spectrum antibiotic therapy. And this is very, very important classification regarding this oral candidiasis. There are two types of oral candidiasis, primary and secondary. Again, in the primary, there is of acute forms, chronic forms. These all are the chronic forms. Candida associated lesions like Danger stomatitis, angular keelitis, and rhomboid glossitis, whereas keratinized primary lesions which are super infected with Candida like leukoplakia, lichen planus, and lupus erythematosus. And secondary oral candidiasis will be of involved with the systemic mucocutaneous candidiasis, mostly because of the endocrinopathy syndrome. And this is the other classification which is given in Burkitt's. And coming to the pseudomembranous candidiasis, here there will be of two forms, acute form and a chronic form. Acute form is also called as a thrush, where we can see with the patients used with antibiotics or HIV, leukemia, and steroid inhalers and infants. And it will present with a adherent white plaques, and this white plaques will appear like a cottage cheese or a curdled milk. And this white plaque contains hyphae, yeast, descamated epithelial cells and debris, and this mostly distributed over buccal mucosa, palate, and dorsum of the tongue. And these scrapings are used to remove these plaques, and if you remove that plaque, there will be of burning sensation and unpleasant state. And the chronic form of pseudomembranous candidiasis mostly seen in the HIV infection. And in this picture, you can see that pseudomembranous type of candidiasis in a heart transplant patient. Then coming to the erythematous candidiasis, it is of three types, where acute atrophic candidiasis or an antibiotic sore mouth, central papillary atrophy or a median rhomboid glossitis, or a chronic multifocal candidiasis or a kissing lesion. So here you can see a erythematous candidiasis with a smooth atrophic tongue present on the dorsum. And here you can see a multifocal candidiasis. Sometimes this tongue lesions touches the palate, by the appearance of the same type of lesion on the palate. Hence it is known as a kissing lesion in oral candidiasis on the hard palate. Coming to the chronic atrophic candidiasis, it is also called as a denture stomatitis. These are of three types. In the type 1, you can see only a minor erythematous sites covered caused by trauma from the denture. In type 2, it affects a major part of the denture. Whereas in type 3, you can see type 2 along with that central part of the palate has a granular mucosa. So this is the type 1, where only a minor sites can be covered. Where is the type 2, where entire alveolar mucosa is covered? This is the type 3, where entire alveolar mucosa and the central palate, you can see a granular type of tissue. Then angular keelitis or keelocandidiasis. Here you can see the fissures of the commissures of the mouth are infected. Here along with the candida, Staphylococcus aureus is also involved. You can see this type of infection in the patients with vitamin B12 and iron deficiencies. And also seen in vertical dimension, where saliva will pool in those folds and at the corner of the mouth, which may lead to increase of this angular keelitis. So you can see in the picture, this is angular keelitis. Then coming to chronic hyperplastic candidiasis, and this is here you can see a white patch which cannot be removed by scraping, whereas pseudomembranous candidiasis is removed by scraping, where here it is not removed with the scraping. Mostly occur on the anterior buccal mucosa, and it cannot clinically be distinguished from a routine leukoplakia. Hence you have to take a biopsy or a smear of the lesion, and you have to examine that. And this is the chronic hyperplastic candidiasis, and it has a more efficiency to turn into the malignancy. and this diagnosis of this hyperplastic candidiasis is confirmed by the presence of candidal hyphae. And if you use the antifungal therapy, it will resolve the completely. So these two will distinguish between the leukoplakia and this hypoplastic candidiasis. Coming to mucocutaneous candidiasis, this is a rare immunological disorder where you can see a complete mucocutaneous involvement, and even there is a part of association of endocrine disorder, and mostly they will appear as a white plaques which do not rub off. In going into the histopathological features, there will be of increased thickness of parakeratin, there is elongation of the epithelial retiridges, and there will be of small collection of neutrophils, that is called as microabscesses. And other differential diagnosis can be given with other white lesions like leukoplakia, hairy leukoplakia, lichen planus, lupus erythematosus, white spongenevus, and chemical burns. So management is, first important thing is you have to remove the predisposing factors, and a high level of oral hygiene should be maintained. And these are the drugs used for it. And for the pseudomembranous candidiasis and candida associated lesions, you can use a itraconazole or a fluconazole. And for erythematous and nodular type 2, nodular type of this thing, you can use a ketoconazole. And for the secondary forms, you can use this type of ketoconazole for about 3 months. And if it is an immunocompromised patient, you have to use the itraconazole oral solution with a dose change. And nystatin oral suspensions can be used for a pseudomembranous type. Miconazole oral gel can be used in the case of angular chelitis, because this miconazole is very effective for both this aureus and the candida. So hence miconazole is used in this angular chelitis cases. So if it is type 3 type of dentate stomatitis, where you will see a granular tissue on the palate, that will go for the surgical excision followed by the topical antifungal agents. So this is all regarding the candidal infection, which is very, very important. I hope you people has understood this. Thank you all. Love learning with MDS Conquer.